So when we talk about film scoring, we usually just think about the final product. We see it in movies. It's almost an afterthought. Wow, that music was really good with that scene. That was paired really well. But that's not the whole picture. And the people we have today are going to let you know that in probably as many terms as there are available. Our first speaker, I'm very proud he was able to come, has worked on a variety of movies, including the Austin Powers series, including, if I'm correct, the third Spider-Man, or was that George? That's this guy. Okay. All right, then we got the Santa Claus as well. Please join me in welcoming one of the cutting edge film score in the industry, George S. Clinton.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thanks, John. Thanks, John Paul. Thanks, John Snyder. It's great to be here. I love being in the Big Easy. I always heave a sigh of relief every time I get off the airplane and walk through the airport and in through the French Quarter. Mothership is calling me. I don't have a cell phone on. I'm not going to do that to you, man. That's just the way I am. I came down here, I guess, for the first time a year and a half, 2 years ago to work on a film I was doing called Extract, which was a comedy that Mike Judge directed. And the Louisiana State Film Commission had given a luncheon and invited Hollywood composers to come out in Los Angeles. And Jay Weigel was there. And gave a speech, and I thought, boy, the next chance I get, I'm going to take a score down there because it sounds like a very cool place to record, and I love New Orleans. And I got to be friends with Jay. The score came out great. The musicians are just terrific down here. And so anyway, glad to be here. Glad to be here with my friend Chris Young. It's funny, we were talking about watching each other when we started up through the industry. You were at New World, I was at Canon Films, you were doing horror movies, I was doing ninja movies, you know, and it's just amazing to see people that you've come up through the industry with, and it's always fun to remember that. Look around, because you're going to see some of those people here that you're going to be coming up through the industry with, and one of the things that I tell people, one of the most important things you can do in this business is to stay in touch with those people that are coming up through the business at the same time you are. Directors, composers, editors, music supervisors, you know, get emails, get phone numbers, make sure that you make the real effort to stay in touch with everybody that you've met along the way, because eventually they're going to get that movie and they're going to remember that you're the composer or the music supervisor or the person that worked with them in college and have stayed in touch with them, and you're going to be the first person they call. And that happens a lot. I was at Sundance this last winter, and I was doing a panel, and there were maybe 10 pairs of composers and directors who had films at Sundance, and almost every one of them came together, not because the director admired the person's work as a film composer, but because the director had become familiar with the person's work through the music they had posted that they had done just for themselves on Facebook or on some other YouTube or some other social network program, or they were part of a band and had done some CDs, and that was the way that the director got familiar with their music. So another thing I say, it's not only important to stay in touch with people and to network, but it's also important to do music and to disseminate music and get it out there in some other form besides film scoring if you can. And you're at a perfect time in history to do that because of all the technology that's available now that allows you not only to create very convincing and interesting music in the privacy of your bedroom, but also to be able then to turn around and post it and disseminate it to countless thousands and sometimes hundreds of thousands of people. So those are two very important things to keep in mind as you go through your career, and give you a little bit of history about how I got into it. I never intended to be a film composer. When I started out, I'm from Tennessee. I grew up in Chattanooga, played in rock bands, went to Middle Tennessee State University where I majored in music and drama. But while I was there, I also started doing session work and writing songs in Nashville and got a feel for recording and decided that when I graduated that I would go to Los Angeles and try to be a rock star like all the other thousands of people that were doing that in the early 70s. And great time to be in Los Angeles, early 70s. If you could stand up for 5 minutes and play and sing a song, you could pretty much get a record deal. And so I was lucky to get 4 record deals during the first 10 years I was there. Wrote songs for Warner Brothers Music, started out as a songwriter, really, and was lucky enough to have some of my songs covered by Michael Jackson and Joe Cocker and Three Dog Night, just a lot of interesting people, because I was sort of into R&B, and they were able to market those songs to those artists. Cheech and Chong happened to come to a club where my band was playing, and came backstage and said, "Hey, dude, you want to do some music for a movie?" And so I said, "Sure." And that's how I got into film scoring almost 30 years ago now. And once I got into it, I realized that's exactly where I needed to be. It was a perfect combination of being in the recording studio, creating music, and because I was always interested in drama and had majored in drama as well as music in school, I got to use both of those interests and some training in both of those in scoring for film. And because I'd come up through the rock side of it, I had that experience, but I also, because I had gone to music school and gotten a degree in it, I had the other side of it to work with as well. So that's sort of the way that I got started and got into it. I used to keep a yellow pad, a legal pad of phone numbers of everybody that I met and I worked with, and I would cycle through that thing once a month, making phone calls, just telling people, "Hey, I'm here, I would love to work with you, what are you up to?" I still do that to some extent. It's not a legal pad now, it's a, you know, a text file on my computer, but I still try to stay in touch with people and let them know that I'm interested in what they're doing and put my name in their RAM, you know, so that it's a current thing. You know, they may have, you know how it is, you get busy on whatever's current and you forget about what was. It's a good thing to do. I'm moving along kind of quickly here. We're going to have a question and answer period later. The way it's going to go down is each one of us is going to come up and give you a little presentation, and you'll have opportunity at the end of the last of Selena's presentation to do, I guess, the Q&A. Isn't that right, John? Great. So I have brought a selection, since this is a song and score symposium, to play for you from a movie I did several years ago called Wild Things, and it's Kevin Bacon and Matt Dillon, and it's a real twisted kind of sordid tale. And the reason I brought this as an example, a lot of times scores and songs seem like they come from different universes when they're in a film. Sonically, they sound different. The whole mood, you know, you can have this wonderful orchestral classic type of score, and suddenly there's this blaring rock piece. And you understand the merchandising aspect behind these creative decisions, but very often that's what it is. It's not an actual creative decision based purely upon trying to make the whole sonic experience of the film as uniform as possible. So I had this opportunity on this film called Wild Things. I knew that a group called Morphine was going to have a song in the film. I knew that a group called K's Choice was going to have a song in the film. They had this wonderful singer named Sarah Bettens. And I knew that Smash Mouth had a song in the film. And they've got a great guitar player named Greg Camp. So Bud Carr was the music supervisor that was working on that film. And I asked Bud to get in touch with the singer from K's Choice, the guitar player that I mentioned, and then the baritone sax and slide bass player from Morphine, and see if they would do a cameo in my score. So they would be playing my music, but it would be their sound. So by the time you heard their song in the score, you'd already heard her voice You'd already heard his guitar sound. You'd already heard the slide bass and baritone sound. So it gave it a lot more of a unified kind of a feeling to it. It's the only opportunity I've ever had to do it. This director I worked with, John McNaughton, was adventurous enough to allow that to happen. Bud Carr, the music supervisor on the film, was adventurous enough to go after this and make it happen. And I had the best time with these people in the studio. They just, you know, loved being involved in it in that way. So this is the main titles from the movie Wild Things. As I said, it's a rather sordid tale. It takes place in Florida. The director wanted to emphasize the reptilian nature of humans. So he starts you'll see it starts in the swamp and eventually winds up at the high school where all this twisted and sordid sexual stuff transpires. It's a good rental, by the way, if you're in for a hot and steamy night. So let's check it out. Can you dim those lights? Is there a way to dim the lights? Yes, thank you. Thanks a lot. Just wanted to say that there's probably things that will be covered in the question and answer and things that the rest of the guys are going to talk about, so I'm just going to stop right now and turn it over to Mr. Jay Weigel.
Give one round of applause for George Vincent over here.
Thank you.
One mic. No, we're not. Thank you. All right. Our next speaker, as George pointed out, is a Loyola faculty himself. He's a film score and arranger. He's been working in the scene for over 25 years. He has been incorporating New Orleans' own brass music into his writings. He's done a plethora of documentaries. I believe the Medea series as well?
I've worked a lot on that.
That's right. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Jay Weigel.
Thank you. I thought what I would do is sort of represent for you guys what kind of opportunities exist outside of Los Angeles, where the other three panelists are from. I've made the choice to live in New Orleans, so outside of the epicenter of film scoring. But and there are some things very peculiar, as you know, about living in New Orleans, and there's some things very peculiar in a positive way about interacting with the film community by living in New Orleans, or more generally speaking, living in Louisiana. And I'll make sure you all know what those little bits and pieces are, because they become part of, if you choose to stay here, your arsenal for hustling work. And ultimately, as George eloquently describes, first his sheet of paper and then now his little text file, I mean, those phone calls are about staying in touch and hustling work, you know, and you've got to really continue to reach out. And so what I was thinking about when I was thinking about this talk was sort of yakking a bit about the different kinds of opportunities that you should look for when you're living outside of Los Angeles, even if you're living in there, and certainly if you're just getting started, as most of you guys and ladies are. And that would be, George mentioned social networks and things, but I would say generically websites. You know, more and more I can tell you people are putting music on websites, more and more the world is beginning to, the business side of music is beginning to understand how to interface with websites, so there's going to start to be more and more controls about what, there's going to be attempts to have more controls about what's up there, so there are opportunities to write music or get your music put up there with your permission and interacting with people, and that's just a way for people to hear your music, as George points out, how many people at Sundance got involved with scoring a film, not because they were out hustling directors, but some guy clicked on a website or social network and heard something, called them up, and it happened. So you can do that wherever you are. Everybody's building websites. There are people in this town, in every town, that they make their living making websites for people. So find out who they are, call them up, take them to lunch, go have a drink with them, and see if you can in some way interface with them. Mentioned documentaries. One of the reasons I do so many is so many people in Louisiana and around the country make documentaries, and they all want music. And at your level, at the stage of your career, do them for free. If they don't have any money, offer to do the music for them, because they get played at Sundance, possibly. They get played at other film festivals around the world. Documentary filmmakers, that's what they do. They hustle and enter film festivals worldwide, because if they can get in Toronto or South by Southwest or Sundance, they have a shot of getting that documentary picked up and sold. So they're going to go out there and hustle their documentary in ways you won't believe, and if your music's in there, it's going along for a really nice ride. And I have certainly gotten gigs from people seeing documentaries I scored, sometimes for nothing, then call me to do something that could be a documentary, or it could be a feature, it could be whatever. So I would say that's another great way, if you're not living in the center of hustling studios and whatnot, hustle independent filmmakers doing documentaries. Commercials, you know, ad agencies everywhere, locally, and some of them have national clients, they do commercials, and they hire music for them. I mean it when I say up front, the money you'll get paid to write 30 seconds of music far outweighs what you can get doing a film in terms of per second. You know, I mean, sometimes budgets for commercials can be next to nothing, but it's not uncommon still for there to be $8,000, $10,000, $12,000, $15,000 budget to do some little piece of 30-second piece of music that very often you can do in your home studio if you have the right equipment. So that's a whole other part of the conversation, is building your arsenal at home of your studio, which if I have any time, I'll yak about that a little. But so doing commercials can be a really wonderful way to, again, write music, get it scored to picture, get it out there, people know who you are, and begin to give you something you can put out there. And with commercials, they're now posting them all on the website. Every client I've ever written in the last 10 years, Thursday I recorded one with Rebirth Brass Band, and we were doing a little 60-second thing. And then halfway through the session, they said, oh, do you think they would do a two-minute version for our website? It's for coffee. It's for French Market Coffee. And so I went and talked to the guys, paid them a little bit of money, and they just jammed a two-minute version of the same piece we'd been doing so it could play on their website. So people will go from all over the world to that website who are interested in coffee and chicory, and that's something that New Orleans is known for, so people will hit it, and they'll hear this band. They'll hear what was done. They'll put your credits up there now even. It's part of the deal I cut with them. You put my credits, and I'll hustle this for you. So there's just all kinds of ways that you should not discount of how you can get your music out there. Well, I also wanted to point out, because I teach, you know, just in the spring here, a film scoring class in through John's program. And I think this year when I asked the kids in the class if any of them belong to BMI, ASCAP, or CSAC, not a single person raised their hand. And what I can tell you is you are just leaving money on the table. And I think I told the class, if by the end of the class you're not a member of one of them, you're going to flunk the class. Because it's absolutely crazy to not get involved in one of those organizations. I'm a member of BMI. I think George is BMI. Chris, are you?
BMI.
BMI. We happen to all be BMI, but ASCAP is one as well. And CSAC, a smaller one, but one to join. And the reason is, when you write music for film, or you license music for film, that when it's playing in a movie theater, what they paid you is what you're going to get, okay, essentially. They're going to give you a certain amount of money to write the music or to use your music, but as soon as that film moves from there to cable, or from cable to network, or network to whatever, broadcast medium, more revenue is created. It doesn't cost the film company anything. It costs the TV stations who are broadcasting, pay BMI, ASCAP, and CSAC money every year so that they can play music on television. CSAC, BMI, and ASCAP collect that money. They divvy it up. They're nonprofits whose job it is to collect royalties from radio and television and all broadcast medium and concerts, etc., and then send it to the composers and publishers of the music. So I can tell you that there are films I have written the score for, or films that I've put a little piece of music in, and I have made more money off the royalties going forward than they paid me. And I was real happy with what they paid me just up front. But you could have it could be something as simple as a $1,000 license in some independent film. And if somehow it gets on television, you might over the next 5 years be pulling in $300 or $400 every quarter from BMI and ASCAP. And if you own the publishing on top of it, multiply that by two. Because the way royalties work is half of it goes to the publishers and half of it go to the writers. So when you're licensing music, and that's kind of a little point I wanted to make with film and television work, is that there is score. George wrote score. I'm going to assume, like most score, we give up the publishing. The film company or the production company will ultimately want to keep the publishing, but you keep your writer's share. So you're going to get 50% of the money. Generally speaking, it's negotiable. So smaller budgets, I've often negotiated retaining some of my publishing to keep some of that revenue for accepting a lower fee. But you might not be able to get that. So you're going to get the writer's share. But the other kind of music you see in a film or hear in a film is source music, what I call source music. So when they're driving in the car and the radio's on, when they're at a party or they're at a bar and there's some background jazz playing that we heard today, they generally the composer doesn't generally write that music. They generally license that music. They find something they like that the director likes. It's part of selling his livelihood, pleasing directors with source music, giving them options, and then they negotiate fees for the use of that music. And so they essentially rent that music from you to put it in their film or in perpetuity. But again, once that film hits television and cable, more revenue is generated for all those licenses that you have out there. And I think I'm safe to say that, except for maybe one or two composers I know of, we all live because of those royalties coming in. Because, you know, we get these gigs, and then we wait and hustle, make those phone calls, and then another gig comes. And in between, these royalties are what's helping us continue to keep everything moving. So the only way you're going to see any of that revenue is if you're a member of one of the performing rights organizations. So you've got to join that right up front. I'm not even sure if studios would license music from people who aren't a member of one of them. I'm not sure. Because I assume they have to protect their investment and make sure that legitimately you own that music you say you own. And that's, I'm sure, one of the ways you feel better about it is knowing that that music's registered and part of the larger system. So you might even be out of the game totally if you're not inside of one of those, or a member of one of those organizations. Now, specific for me, down here, where I've been able to find my niche, not just as a composer, but one of the ways I've been able to help, because I'm really committed to the idea that New Orleans and Louisiana should have a very vibrant recording scene for film and television, and we haven't quite yet conquered that, and the state has set up some tax incentives I'll talk about that help that. So one of the ways I got involved in that was, as George mentioned, starting to help the state when they would go out to Los Angeles, and sort of talk to composers and just say, look, and I think it's, again, safe to say musicians like talking to musicians, composers like talking to composers, and it's just easier to trust someone that does something similar to what you do once they decide if you really know what you're talking about. And so I've had luck with convincing people like George that I do know what I'm talking about and can help them. And the reason they should come down here has to do with these tax incentives the state has. So that when you come to Louisiana and you record in Louisiana, or if you live in Louisiana and you record, and in a 12-month period, if you spend just more than $15,000, which for a film is not hard to have happen at all, but even if you're doing small projects, guys, over 12 months, you can bundle them together. You will have the state write you a check for 25% of it back. So if you spend $20,000 in 12 months recording music for something, when you finished, the state, and you file your little report, the state's going to mail you $5,000. Okay? Now you think about that in terms of fees, and where, again, where I've approached people like George and Chris, is we have what's called package deals as composers. You know, if you get a real big project, very often the studio pays you a creative fee, and then the studio has a separate budget for recording the music. But with a package fee, they essentially give the composer a chunk of money and say, whatever you don't spend is yours. Okay? So you're on the hook to write the music, record it, and deliver it to the production company. And if they paid you $50,000 and you spend $52,000, you've lost $2,000. If you give you 50 and you spend 40, you've made $10,000. But if you do that work in Louisiana and record it in Louisiana and they pay you 50 and you spend 40, well, the state's going to send you 25% of 50 back. So you're going to make, on top of the 10 grand that you saved by not spending it, producing and writing and recording that music, the state's going to send you another $12,500. So you're going to make $22,500. Recording and writing that music in Louisiana. Well, that becomes a very attractive thing for composers, no matter where they live, to think that they can come down here, assuming they can get recorded the quality they want to record and the musicianship the way they need it on the budget that they can do. They know that within a month or two, 3 months after they're finished and all the reports go in, they're going to get a check back. So that has become a big hook to try to get folks to come down here and record music. In that process, you get film companies who come down here because there's a whole nother tax incentive for shooting films down here. They come in, well, very often they need someone to help them locally if they need a musician for a scene. I know Joe's band's been in a television show, Memphis Beat, because they needed a band. I called Joe, he put his band together and they flew out, you know, they drove on out to the set and spent the day pretending to play a song that had been pre-recorded back in Los Angeles. But they needed someone to pull that together. So I have found that's another great spot that I've been helping productions with, is helping them navigate locally. And the two example, well, the one example I thought would be of great interest, because it's how these things happen. was I was working in that capacity for this film, The Lucky One, that just shot here. Warner Brothers just shot a film here called The Lucky One with Zac Efron, was down here for 2-3 months shooting a film. And in that film, they needed someone. Zac Efron was supposed to be able to play piano, and this little fella in the film was supposed to be able to play violin. So they needed me. They just called me at first to get coaches and help coordinate the schedule of getting a piano coach to go and a violin coach to go work with these guys to teach them how to play this one tune, or to make them look like they could play this one tune. They were going to record the song back in Los Angeles, but they needed them to play it in the scene. So I worked with that, aligned it all up. The lady right here was the piano coach, and worked with them. And then when they would have to shoot the scene, we would go out to the set and be a part of it and help the director, you know, let them, if there were problems, kind of help smooth it out and whatnot. And as that relationship developed, it turned out, well, they had a choir piece they wanted in the thing. So they said, well, Jay, do you think we could record that piece here? So I said, well, sure. So we put together a choir for them of 10 or 12 people, supposed to be a small little church choir. We recorded the piece here. That they were thrilled because that now went into their tracks credit land. They got their money back on that. And of course, then they needed that band for the shoot. So we arranged to get the band to go and spent the day. And of course, the whole time you're being compensated for this work for them. Then it turned out they had another scene. They said, well, Jay, we got this scene and we've decided we're going to have a band playing in the background. Do you have any music we can license for it? So out of that, I said, well, sure. I sent them 4 or 5 pieces. They picked the 2 they wanted. So I started out helping them get coaches for their players and ended up licensing 2 pieces into the film and being compensated along the way for all the other work and coordinating that. And so these things just grow. It's back to George and the relationship with people. As it grows and they trust you, believe me, they will call you endlessly because the thing they want the most is as little trouble as possible to get things accomplished. And if you deliver for them, they just call you, and it will grow, and it's been wonderful. The other little example I'll give has to do with the Tyler Perry films. One of the first ones, one of the ones I worked on with them was called Why Did I Get Married? And in that film, when they shot the very last scene at a party, they were had a band playing. It was like a dinner party, and people get up and give their little speeches. Then the band plays as they cut and go to end title credits. And in the scene, when they shot it, they had the band playing Satin Doll. Well, as it turned out, they didn't want to, whatever, when they tried to negotiate the fees on it, I guess they never intended to negotiate and pay for Satin Doll. They would have done that up front. So what they sent me was the scene of the band playing. And they said, Jay, we need a piece of music to put in place of this. So what I had to do was take that scene, kind of build a click track to it, create a new jazz piece that had the saxophone moving his fingers when they cut to him, and sort of create a piece of music that looked like what they were playing, and then re-record that piece down here. And again, on that was one where I got to keep the publishing on it and the writer's share on it, and they paid to produce it down here. I got the tax credit on it and just built this project, became a really wonderful, lucrative project. And with Tyler Perry films, they all end up on television, so they all just create an amazing stream. And I think that was one of the first ones I did with him, and I guess now I've been able to put music in 5, 6, 7 of his films. And really, that's sort of the main point of it, is doing whatever you can to get your toe into that water with somebody, and then those relationships will develop and grow. But you've got to get your performing rights organization set up, you know, get in there, create a publishing company to publish your own music, and get all your business signed. And lastly, I'll throw at you, when you're recording this music, and I don't care, I was telling Selena, I don't care if it's your mother who's playing drums on it, make sure she signs a piece of paper that's a release that gives you, whether it's a work for hire, or if you're doing it through the union, make sure you file your union paperwork. If it's a work for hire, make sure every musician signed the piece so that when you license something to someone, there cannot be a legal issue that pops up where someone comes up and says, well, I played on that, I want some money for that. And you pull out your paper and go, well, no, you signed the release here saying that this was a work for hire, or it's going to run through the union, whatever the circumstances are. So handling that paperwork that I'm sure your program emphasizes is critical, because I have heard endlessly from every music supervisor I've ever worked with, they're at the sound stage, and somewhere in their career, some intern has said, oh, I know that piece. And they've stopped and said, what do you mean you know that piece? They thought it was, someone had said it was their piece, it was someone else's piece. And it just stops the film. A little thing like that will just stop the film, because they've got to go research that, and if it's true, get a new piece in it. And what I can guarantee you is, you will, that whoever licensed or attempted to license that piece will never hear from that film person again. On top of which, it feels like there's only about 40 people doing that work, so you are just shut out of the industry totally. Because if I do it to person X, someone's going to hear about it. They're going to tell them, I had a problem with that guy, and it's just off. So being real straight, keeping all your paperwork, getting it all up front is really things that are critical to being able to build and sustain a career. And if you're going to stay here in Louisiana, utilizing these tax incentives to help you get your work done, maximize your return from doing the work, getting other folks to come down will be critical as well, because those are the little stepping stones that really ultimately over your lifetime piece together an amazing experience and a great living. So I will stop there and turn it over to John Paul again.
Thank you very much, Jay. All right, our next speaker, I'm very proud to present. This man started at UCLA Film School in the 80s and their film scoring program, moved on to the thriller horror scene with Hellraiser and Nightmare on Elm Street 2, moved on to do more widespread work on Copycat 1995, and has recently done such films as Spider-Man 3, Drag Me to Hell, and Beauty Shop. Please join me in welcoming the one and only, Christopher Young.
No? Yes? It's good? Oh, good, good. Hello, my friends. How are you today? Tell me, what percentage of you all are composers out here? A lot of you, okay. And what percentage of you that are composers want to get in film scoring or thinking about doing it? Good. Then I'm hoping our short time together here may turn things around for you, because if you're anything like me, I'm from New Jersey, and I, like you, when I was about your age, had dreams of getting into film scoring, and of course was scared shitless that if I moved to LA, which I knew I had to do, as you will ultimately, I'm going to somewhat contradict what Jay has just said, but I think if you are serious about film scoring, I and you're at the age now where you can afford to be irrational and go out and try something for the hell of it, because what's the worst that can happen? If it doesn't quite work out, you can always come back. Now, I'm often asked, because I teach at USC in the film's graduate scoring program, what's required to be a film composer? What is it that's going to make it work for me as opposed to not working? And my answer to that question is so hard to give a definitive answer to that one, because it's the question that eludes all of us. But in essence, I've always thought that the first and foremost thing one has to have is a psychotic love for film music. Now, how do you know if you've got it? You'll know if you've got it sooner or later, because I've often humorously said to my students, I wouldn't suggest that you jump off the Golden Gate Bridge in the name of film music, but I think at times you're going to have to consider jumping off the bridge in its behalf, because film scoring, as George would say, would agree with me, it's such a time-consuming and intense occupation. It completely consumes your life, and when you're on a project, you're under the gun and trying to get to a deadline, and as a consequence, you have to write music like there was no, like nothing else, because in fact, film composers are the most prolific music makers in the world. So, in terms of our time together, if nothing else you get from me, I'm hoping to God that I can encourage those of you who want to pursue film music to move out here. And to that end, I might as well do this right now. I'm going to give you my phone number because I do teach at USC. I have a building, actually, that I bought. That's a housing facility for composers just like yourself who want to come out and check out the scene in LA. And it's virtually rent-free, and it's like a music community halfway house. And you can stay there for 4 months. So here's my cell phone number. It's 310-220-7710. The place is called the Tilden House, and I've had composers from all over the world come and stay there for 4 months. And it's, what's that? One more time. 310-220-7710. Now, like I said, the nice thing about a place like this is that it gives you a chance just to check out LA to see whether or not, first of all, you like the place. Because let's face it, if you don't fall in love with LA or don't find that you like it enough, it's going to be a tough move. Because LA is a unique city. Much different than New York City, much different than here as well. I've often found that the composers in LA are much more willing to open their doors to you. It always surprised me when I used to go, when I was studying at UCLA, I could drive right by Jerry Goldsmith's house. And if I had the guts, which I did at one point build up the guts to go and knock on his door, I could. If you live in New York City, you know, Leonard Bernstein was at the top of a high rise. You couldn't get in there unless you got permission from the doorman. But in LA, people were accessible. That's the wonderful thing. And as a general rule, I think that most composers out there are more inclined to want to assist you and support you in your pursuit of making this dream come true. Now, I say moving to LA is important. Matter of fact, I think it's necessary. I remember when I first moved out there, the very first seminar I ever went to was hosted by Henry Mancini. And Henry Mancini, at one point, you know, here he's standing on a stage, and in this instance, the stage was way up here, and the seats were way down there, and I was like in the front row looking up at Henry Mancini, and I was saying, this guy doesn't really understand. It's been so long since he was struggling. He's now a superstar, you know, living in Beverly Hills. Westwood, Bel Air. He's living in Bel Air. I thought, you know, he's probably lost contact with the incredible pain that we all go through trying to establish our careers. And he did say something that sort of made sense to me. He said, you know what, everyone in the room, you made the move to Los Angeles, and that has made you more capable of building the career that you want to have happen. For every one of you that is here, there are hundreds or thousands of those who will talk about wanting to get into film scoring, but perhaps will never make it out here. And so the smartest thing you did was moving out here. It's the first step to making that career happen. So again, I encourage you to move out there. Now, we talk about what kind of talent do I have to make it as a film composer? Do I have to be like super, super talented? No, the great news is that though maybe once upon a time, if you look back in the film scoring that was going on in the 30s, the 40s, and the 50s by people like Max Steiner, Eric Wolfgang Korngold, Bernard Herrmann, David Raxon, Franz Waxman, all these people, the quality of the writing was top flight. I'm not saying that the quality of the writing is not top flight now, but it doesn't necessarily require that you have a supreme knowledge of how to write successfully for the orchestra. there are different venues that you can go in, and if you have a language that is removed from that orchestral language, it doesn't mean you're not going to have a career. You very well can have a career. Meaning that you, the great news is you don't have to be a genius to have a career in Hollywood. I mean, look at, I mean, I, you know, it's like, like look at Arnold Schwarzenegger. I mean, for instance, I mean, brilliant guy at managing his career, but he in his own he himself said, "I'm no actor." But look, no, he's you know, but look what he did with his career. It's so much in LA about selling yourself. Of course, you have to have talent for sure. As I said, you have to be obsessively compulsive and madly in love with film music. And that, so many of the, most of the success stories, I think that is the resonating chord that holds, ties all of the stories together, is that passion, that obsessive passion. You have to have, like I said, talent. You have to, as Jay pointed out, develop a repertoire of people who believe in your talents, and certainly when you move out to LA, you have to be willing to work for free. Don't be stupid and think that, like I did, when I moved out there my first year, thinking that, you know, if I don't get my name up in the silver screen within that first year, and if I'm not making money doing it, I'm fooling myself. And as they say, when you move out to Los Angeles, if you can survive your first year, you're on the road to success. Most of my students, my first job is to try to convince them to create a more realistic timetable. It's like I said, most everyone moves out there and they think it's going to happen within a year. And I've seen so many people pack up and go home way too prematurely because they have unrealistic expectations. So my thing is I tell everyone, give it a five-year period, even before you, 3 to 5 years, even before you begin to consider whether or not you may have made a mistake. Because in fact, you never know when success is going to strike. Now, the great news is that we're composers here, and we don't have to worry about not looking so beautiful after the age of 27, right? If you're on the screen, it could be a problem, but you're behind the screen. As a matter of fact, most composers who write for film get better as they age. You know, it's like, no, truly. It's like, it's you know, it's the nice thing about being a composer, and history has shown us that in the world of classical music, most composers got better as they got older. There's room for growth. If you want to be a rock star, there's usually a very small window when that happens, from the age of whatever, 18 to 33, and there 35, and then you're kind of out. But the great news about film scoring is you can grow and become wiser and better. Now we have some examples. In the old days, look at Max Steiner. Max Steiner, you know, is probably best known for his wonderful theme, the Tara theme for Gone with the Wind. Now, here's a composer who didn't move to Hollywood till he was in his 40s, okay? And from the age of 42 until he was retired in his 80s. I mean, he was working until his early 80s. As a matter of fact, one of his later scores was a film called Summer Place, and he wrote a theme for that, which, you know, became a hit when he was in his 80s. I'm sure you've heard this tune. You know the tune, the Summer Place? Can you hum it? I'm pretty... Da da dee da da, da dee da dee da da. Yeah, that's Max Steiner at the age of 80. Okay, shows you there's still room for growth. But here he was, a guy who started later. And in the course of his life, scored over, he was in the, I think, the 300 plus club. Worked on over 300 movie scores. Now, some of them were just main and end titles, but nonetheless, he was connected to over 300 movies in his career. Now, we have a recent example. There's a guy named Gustavo Santaolalla. And he's Argentinian, is it? Where is he from?
Yeah,
Argentinian. Now, he won two Oscars in a row two or three years ago. Broke my mind. What was the other one? Which one? Yeah, okay. Here's a guy who's in his 50s, who starts, this is like his fourth score. Brokeback Mountain was maybe his third or fourth score. Not bad batting average, you know. So the good news is don't worry about, because that's often first go, oh, aren't I too old, Chris? Aren't I too old? No. You're never too old. Okay. Let's see here. Of course, you have to have collaborative skills. You ain't going to go nowhere if you can't work with directors, which means you have to humiliate yourself and know that you are trying to illuminate their vision of what the film is. There's no one that knows any better about what the movie's about than the director himself. Now, of course, there's going to be other people who are going to have opinions, and you have to determine, well, who's really running the show here? In features, it's usually the director. The producer will come along and give his seal of approval. The music supervisor will be a part of it, trying to facilitate communication between you, the director, and the producer. The editor is frequently an extremely important voice, if not the most important voice, because most directors are terrified of talking about music. They don't know how to do it. And so you have to try to, my job, I think all of our jobs, and I think the composers who do the best, have the best careers in Hollywood, try their best to get inside the director's mind and see the film from their point of view. Now, you have to start to learn their language. I work with a director on a film called Set It Off with Queen Latifah. And that director, who's a first-time director, he'd come out of the music video world, and you'd think if there was anyone who could talk music, it would be someone who worked in the music video world. Well, no, that was not the case. The language he came up with was using colors. He'd talk about, I want the music to be, you know, blue, or, you know, need to be dark, and, you know, he would use colors, basically, to explain what he was looking for. And so I would have to, in time, over a period of time, figure out what the hell did he mean when he said blue. And then, but by the time we got on the scoring stage, he went, man, Chris, that's real blue. And I knew I'd gotten it, you know. So you have to try to work your way into the language of the director. Now, frequently, as you know, as film composers, for every note we write, there's two that get thrown out, usually. So either because we're not happy with it, or definitely they're not happy with it. So it's all about being willing to revise your thoughts and do it gracefully. I've often said to my students, if you're having problems with the director, you think he's a fool, and he's driving you crazy because he's asking for something or critiquing or finding fault in something you thought was the best cue you ever wrote, what you need to do is excuse yourself in the room, go into the bathroom, shut the door, make sure he can't hear you, scream at the top of your lungs what an idiot he is, and then come back in the room and go, and now how can I help you? You know, so you have to be very graceful on that one. Let's see here, show business. Yes, show business. We all know that Hollywood is Hollywood because of show business. There's a film composer named Bruce Broughton, and I got to know him over a period of time. What were his big movies were? Silverado. He was nominated for an Oscar for that. Young Sherlock Holmes, lots of other films. And he said to me, Chris, don't forget, this is show business. And it's about selling yourself always. My biggest shortcoming, let's face it, every composer is insecure, right? Every person who works in movies is insecure. I've often kind of felt that the careers that survive, that last the longest, are those people who seem to manage to disguise their insecurities, to try to create the illusion they're pretty secure. So, what you want to do is you want to make sure that you taper that insecurity, like that insecure aspect. The thing that nearly blew my career when I started off was letting the directors know, or the producers know, that I wasn't quite satisfied with what I was doing. I was being haunted by my desire to outdo either Bernard Herrmann or Jerry Goldsmith. Those were my two big heroes. And nothing I could do was as good as them. So I would stay up all night long trying to perfect each cue and say, is this as good as Jerry Goldsmith? Is it as good as, no, it was never good enough. And I would let the director know, like, oh, Chris, how's it going? I go, well, you know, sort of okay. And so I got the reputation of being the guy that don't pay any attention to what Chris says about what he's doing. Wait till he gets on the scoring stage, you're going to love it. It's great stuff. He's going to try to convince you it's not great. And I nearly killed my career doing that. One thing I also learned was, you can shoot yourself in the foot numerous times, up to 3 times for the same reason, and then you're in trouble. Jay, you mentioned the example of music supervising or licensing something and blowing your opportunity on that, and then having your career kind of shut down. It's true. Everyone makes mistakes, but what you have to do is you have to learn from your mistakes. As they say, Hollywood is basically nothing but a series of comebacks, maintaining a career, and that's kind of true. And most people do make mistakes. People shoot themselves in the foot for some reason or another. In my case, it was that I was very insecure, and I continued to shoot myself in the foot. I got about the third time, my agent finally said, Chris, stop this now. This is not going to work. You have to modify this, or you're not going to get any calls. And so the smart people don't blame Hollywood for their problems. They try, first of all, to examine what it is that they are doing right or wrong and try to modify them, their behavior. Let's see here. Okay, everyone gets breaks in different ways. How do you get in, right? George mentioned that he was a rock and roll performer, and he meets Cheech and Chong in a club. It was a club, right? Yeah. Now, what would have happened had he not been, if he gotten sick that night and he hadn't gone and played with a band and had to get a sub? Or what happens if Cheech and Chong hadn't gone to the club that night? Who knows where his career would be today? I'm sure he'd still be the great film composer he is, but it probably would have happened in a different manner. Everybody gets in a different way, right? There's no two stories that are alike. However, there are certain types of success stories that you hear about. One is precisely this. You come from a rock and roll world, and you immediately shoot to the head of the class, especially if you're a superstar. We have examples. Danny Elfman, from Oingo Boingo. If he hadn't been with Oingo Boingo, who knows where his career would be. There was Stuart Copeland from The Police, who was a film composer. James Newton Howard was the keyboardist for Elton John. That opened up the door for him. Howard Shore was the music supervisor for Saturday Night Live, and that certainly helped open up the door for him. So if you're a rock star, good show, but I'm assuming that you're here because you're not rock stars. So how are the other ways you can get in? Well, again, this is not going to work for you either, I'm assuming, but that's nepotism. There's the Newman family, the dynasty, the Newman dynasty, Alfred Newman, Lionel Newman, Emil Newman, Randy Newman, Tommy Newman, David Newman. You got a family name. Even Jerry Goldsmith's got a son. Elmer Bernstein had a son. And that certainly opened up doors. The other way to get in, of course, is, you go through school. This is the way I did it. And you spend a lot of time getting to know directors and doing student films. Now, I don't know if there's a lot of student films available here at this school, or if there's a lot of student films making going on somewhere here in New Orleans, but certainly that's the smart way to go. I beg of you, if you're serious, to try to find anything that anyone is making that requires music, and do that for free. What you want to do right now is you want to go out and you want to let everyone know you're the go-to person that will deliver music to them free of charge. Don't worry about it. You're going to love it, and we're going to have a great time. We're going to have a great time together because I'm going to realize your vision. Right? You understand? So that was the way I got in. I moved out to Los Angeles, went to UCLA, which for me was the perfect halfway house into LA. You know, and I do recommend a school, if you are still into that after you finish up here, as a means to gracefully ease yourself into Los Angeles, because it can be overwhelming. And you can get very depressed the first year. As I said, if you can survive your first year, you're on the road to success. So yes, indeed, it was working with student filmmakers. My first 20 movies of the 100-something I've done, the first 20 I could trace the reason why I got that to some connection I'd made when I was at UCLA. Now, none of the directors I worked with went on to direct, but a lot of them got work in post-production, either editing, picture or sound, or doing something, PA or whatever, lighting, makeup, and they would recommend me. And so that's why you need to have constantly expanding the repertoire of people who believe in your talent. That's why you've got to befriend as many people as you possibly can. You know, there's a lot of examples as well of composers who got connected to that right director when they were starting off. Man, if you can find the right director when you're starting off, you're in like Flynn. You know, Williams had been around for a while. He'd been doing things, but let's face it, it was when he made that connection with George Lucas and Steven Spielberg that basically overnight he became a sensation. And they carried him, and they're still carrying him as they move forward in their lives and their careers. Again, bringing Howard Shore up, who won the Oscar for, three Oscars for, which was the movies?
Lord of the Rings.
This is Howard Shore. He's Canadian, and he met the Canadian director, David Cronenberg, and together they became a team, and as Cronenberg moved up the ladder, he insisted that Shore moved with him. There is Carter Burwell, who with the Coen brothers, they took Carter with him, with them as they moved up the ladder, so that's a good way to go too. Meet as many directors as you can, and try to link, of course, attach yourself to a good one. Now, having said that, frequently we make a mistake of thinking, oh, I've just watched this movie, it's a student movie, it stinks, why do I want to bother scoring this? No, I don't care. It's just almost some image is moving and it's not porno, you know? You probably should do it because you never know who is going to, you know, everyone connected with this? You never know where they're going to go. You should do anything and everything that comes your way. And even if you got to do porno, you do porno, right? Just use a pseudonym, I guess. Let's see here. Now, we're going to talk a little bit before I close the show up here. I teach at USC, as I said. And my year there is usually divided into two parts. I'm going to try to pass on to you something that I think is pretty important for composers to be thinking about. Now, again, as you can see, I'm old school. I've been around for a while. I do believe what I'm about to mention to you is something that will serve you well as composers. And I'm going to play an example, I think, if I have time, right?
We have some. I only have some of examples up. Let me know which one you want.
Do you have... the score to Shipping News?
These are what I have here. You see that?
Right. The good, the bad, and the ugly. No, this is the wrong file. Well, that's Drag Me to Hell.
These are the other clips we have. Hey! That's all we have there.
That's it?
Yeah.
Oh, Christ. You gotta be kidding me. There's no list of musical selections, like a long list.
There is, but I can't.
All the clips are loaded last night.
These are the three that were sent to
those
us.
That's the only three that came through?
No, I have a few more, but the ones on this list right here.
That's it? That's everything? No idea.
Did you want to skip on the clip?
I'm sorry, what?
Did you want to skip on the clip? Do you want to show the loser?
Well, I guess I'm going to have to. Okay, here's the point I'm going to make. And we'll see if I can find something there that demonstrates this. To me, in the short history of film scoring, what is apparent is that at the end of the day, what are film composers most remembered for? That one tune, or the group of tunes that are connected with the right picture at the right time. Fortunately, it is the title of the picture which is the single most important thing at the end of the day. For instance, going back to Max Steiner, if that wonderful theme he wrote for Tara, Gone with the Wind, we know this theme, if he'd written that theme for the mutant purple people eater from Planet X, Part 2, that theme would have been forgotten. So it was the right movie and the right theme for the right movie. A lot of wonderful scores have been attached to pictures that sort of went nowhere and sort of sank like the Titanic. And as the ship goes down, everybody goes down with it. So a lot of scores have been lost, really great scores have been lost to films that have been forgotten. You look at Max Steiner's work, and I bet you he's in heaven right now going, God damn it, there's that bloody theme of mine being brought up again. That was not my favorite. As a matter of fact, I think one of his favorites was for a film, his score was for a film that was somewhat successful, but not really well remembered today. It was a film called She, and that was one of his favorites. But that score's been kind of forgotten because the film's been kind of forgotten. So you have to get attached to the right picture. But so even the most complex work that we can do, there's certain composers who've done remarkably interesting stuff. One that comes to my mind immediately is Leonard Rosenman, who did the score of the first 12-tone score in Hollywood for a film called Cobweb. Amazingly intelligent and wonderful score. But at the end of the day, that's not what he's really remembered for. He's probably remembered for some of the themes that he wrote. So at the end of the day, it is themes. So that's my big thing with my class at USC. I bash this into their head, their need to be able to write themes that are instantaneously memorable. So to all of you composers out there, if you haven't had the opportunity to start to focus on writing themes, memorable themes, instantaneously memorable themes, I suggest you do this. Now, you can have a brilliant career and never write a single tune in that entire career. This whole sound design approach to film scoring is much more prevalent now. But even the best of those have some little motive or some little sound bite that keeps reappearing that we remember, right? Yes, themes are desperate, are so significant. The best scores historically have been proven to be comprised of 1 to 6 or 7, not many more than that, because then it gets confusing. Memorable themes that are, like I said, instantaneously remembered and then are put through a series of variations. No good themes, no good variations. We talk about John Williams as being one of the great film composers, living film composers, and one of the greatest film composers of all time. What is it that makes his stuff special is that he has these incredibly brilliant tunes that hold these scores together. There's a lot of composers who've tried to write like John Williams but haven't quite gotten it because they're missing that tunefulness that makes his work so special. So, song form. The American public has spoken, and this is the way they think. They like to put on the radio, they like to hear someone singing something to them in song form. So I think the key to hooking your director and your audience is by presenting your ideas in song form. When I do show and tells on a movie, I sit down with the director, we talk about the music needs to be. First cue I generally show will be the main title for my first show and tell, and I do a mock-up of that if it's going to be an orchestra thing. And then what? And then I will, the mock-up I usually will do, offer them two to three different takes on the movie, or at least the main title, which probably will be the main theme for the movie. And they're always in song form, if the film will allow it. And that's something that directors really get. You know, they understand it, because let's face it, when they're driving home, they're not listening to Schoenberg on the radio. They're listening to rock and roll, probably. So song form, I think, is critical. I say to my class, write a tune a day, and that'll keep the BMI in pay, or whatever. Get in the habit of getting up in the morning, and as you're brushing your teeth, try to come up with a tune. Go, I'm doing a Western, I'm doing a big epic Western, or I'm doing a sci-fi film, or I'm doing a romantic movie. What's that theme? And just get your cassette machine out and hum into the machine what that tune is. Don't make the mistake of writing at the piano. With my students, I tie their hands behind their back, because as you know, you sit at the piano and your fingers will take the tune places that your brain doesn't want it to go. Your brain doesn't lie, does it? It may give you shitty ideas, but it will at least give you the real ideas that it's carrying at that moment. Using your fingers to help articulate those ideas is not a bad thing. But letting your fingers do the walking is a bad idea. So, to end up my time here, I'm going to try to find an example, unlike the one that I was hoping to play for you, which does use song form. I just don't understand this. What the hell is the Magnificent Seven got to do? You know, I think I saw Drag Me to Hell, right? DMTH, Drag Me to Hell. No, it was on the screen. I saw the picture. The only thing I've seen a film picture of is this right here. Yeah. Now, I'm hoping this is going to be the main title to Drag Me to Hell with a work print. It's just going to feature music. This is a horror film directed by Sam Raimi, with whom I worked on Spider-Man 3, Spider-Man 2, and The Gift with, what's her name? I can't remember actresses' names. Okay, now, this was, I had a show and tell with him, and I showed him mock-ups, exactly the same thing. I showed him three different versions. The first one, he listened to go, no, that's not it, Chris. I like the tune, but it's not it. This was the second of the three. He fell in love with this one after a period of time. It wasn't immediate, but he did like this. You're going to see that it's in song form. Now, this is not an easy tune to remember. I'm going to be the first to admit that. But hopefully by the end of this main title, even if you don't like the melody, you will have something implanted in your brain so that when it keeps reappearing throughout the picture, you'll have made that reference. Okay? So hopefully I will succeed in planting something in your mind. If this is...
Yeah, it's from the server. I don't think we're going to get it.
We're not going to get it?
Yeah, that was it.
That's it?
Unless it is on here, we can get it.
It should be on there. Okay. So we have time for this. We don't have time for this now. It's just blown.
We can put it on after.
Sure. I'm sorry, friends. Well, you got through the intro. You were hearing the beginning of the A. You were about to get into the B section, but structurally, it goes intro, A, B, coda, out. So I'm sorry you're not going to be able to hear it, but it does utilize song form. So, my friends, in conclusion, we're going to start answering questions here, but in case this question doesn't come up, I would love nothing more than to be a part of your lives if indeed you are serious about getting into film scoring. I do teach at USC. The program is the best in the world, in the universe, as far as I can tell. I don't think there's any filmmaking or scoring going on in Planet X. There might be. Pluto, I don't know. Never been up there. So it's the best program in the world. UCLA also has a program. If you're thinking of moving out there and want to get in the academic or use that as a halfway house. But again, you have my phone number. Give me a ring. And number two is if you want to stay at that place I was talking about, that's a good way to check the scene out. Okay? So hopefully we'll be a part of each other's lives if you want to pursue this film music thing in LA. Right? Good.
We will get that clip happening. Don't you worry. But we have one more speaker for you for our film portion. It's someone a little bit different, someone who's not quite a film scorer, though she has a background in classical and film composition. She currently works as a music supervisor and a music coordinator for New Music, the company, not just New Music in general. New Image, excuse me, thank you. And some of her work, some of the placements she's done, can be seen in the Conan?
Not yet.
Ah, that's right. So join me in welcoming Selena to our stage.
All right, everybody, just to come full circle here. George was saying how his beginnings were in this industry, and industry is indeed, Chris Young was actually the first person who gave me kind of my first toe dipping into the film industry after I have finished the degree at the USC. So I think I'm going to be a little bit more of a link between what these three phenomenal gents were saying this morning, and then what you're going to be hearing about this afternoon with regards to songs in the film and so on. I'm really that link between the music that exists, that is available for films, and whatever the music is that ends up in the final cut of the film. My title is Music Supervisor. To a lot of people, it looks like and sounds like a very interesting career. Basically, what do? You listen to music all day. Well, to just give you a little bit of a background of what my daily life is like. Yes, I am ultimately responsible for delivering to the production company, which is New Image Millennium Films, whatever music is that ends up in the film. But I work with composers whom we end up hiring for the film to score the original music for. I select and suggest various songs. If somebody asks me, what is it that I listen to on a daily basis, or what is the music that I like, it is everything and anything from every genre you can possibly imagine. My day might be listening to the music for a horror film which wants to implement some sort of a, I don't know, very current sounding alternative rock band, to, let's say, listening to some source music for Conan, which is an action adventure film that happens basically before we had any form of civilization. So what is it? What is the source music that some group, tribal group in the middle of nowhere will be listening to while they're partying? You know, we'll find something, I'm sure. But or if it's some sort of a subtle jazz piece that might work to either support the story of the film or might be just in the background. Or recently, I have supervised a film where we had a scene in this city, which had a more traditional Zydeco band on camera. We actually did not just have people, like Jay was saying, who were in the scene just acting out. We actually had the band and the actual singer and so on. So all these various things are creative part of the job. Once we know sort of what music is going to be in the film, there is a large part of the job which is licensing music, hiring composer, going through all kinds of paperwork, making sure that whatever music is in the film is protected by BMI, ASCAP, CSAC, any other PRO that stands for a performing rights organization from any part of the world. It is not so much that the production company will not accept to have the music that is not protected in the film for just their own sake. It's not only that. It is that the film will see the light of day, hopefully, after it is all shot and you know, wrapped up, and it will get into the hands of the distributors or it will end up on, you know, TV, theaters, Netflix, I don't know what. People who bring you these films need to know that they are protected in the best possible way. So there is that part of the business that needs to be taken care of. And then, just by virtue of working for a production company, film company, even though it's independent film production, which means it's not a major studio such as Universal, Fox, Warner Brothers, and so on, the company has managed to retain certain publishing rights of certain number of films. So they have built the library of the music that they own themselves. So sometimes that music actually kind of makes a full circle and ends up in some other of their films. Sometimes it is presented to outside world and is used in trailers or other films or other TV productions of other companies and so on. So we actually is it okay?
Sorry, yeah, you're fine.
You know, tracking all that down, administering that whole library of music is yet another part of the job that I do. But all three of these categories are equally important. I cannot really say that you can have just the music without the business part of it. It is industry after all, and there is a reason why they call it a business. there is an interesting connection between the two. Sometimes you would think that you know certain decisions that are made about bringing the certain music into the film are senseless or maybe do not necessarily appeal to you as a musician or as a composer or as a songwriter at the moment. But the more flexible you are and the more you can kind of get your head into that particular game in that particular moment, I think that would help your success if indeed you decide to go that way. So at any rate, I think that we are going to have a question and answer panel. I can address any questions you might have, but in a nutshell, that's what I do.
Sorry about that.
Okay, so we're going to set up for our panel. If you have any questions that came up, I know that we received some emailed to us. Be sure to think about them. We're going to bring some mics down and have them in the aisle, so be sure to ask them through the mics. This feed is being webcasted, and we want them to be heard by our audience as well. While we are getting set up, we're going to go ahead and play that clip that Christopher Young brought up earlier. We got it working now. We're going to play this clip. You set it up, so I'm excited. I need to see this clip now. Can we dim the lights? We could have our film scores coming up and take a wonderful seat with our beautifully dressed table here. All right, so Anthony B. Has the first question for the panel here. He wanted to know, how would he go about getting his band's music in movies? Anyone have any idea about getting a band's music placed in movies, what that process is like?
Every living, breathing, remotely known to mankind music supervisor. and it will take you places from there. What happens once your band's music is submitted, it enters the pool of many other bands that are in that vein, that are very closely alike, or very remotely alike, or maybe your song has a relevant lyrics to a particular scene or something like that, it will therefore be considered for a placement in the film or not. So, you know, it starts from there. Music supervisors everywhere, we hope, listen to a lot of music, and even if we are not able to actually make a placement on a current field that we are working on, it gets filed. And most importantly, it gets filed somewhere in our RAM memory of our brain. And I would know, oh yes, you know, I have heard these guys and they were great. And, you know, where did I put that? I will pull out that MP3 or CD or something like that and listen to it again. So, and, you know, take it from there, suggest it to the director, to the producers, whoever the decision maker, or even if we are early on in the game, which I often appreciate, is I will suggest it to editors who are still cutting the film to actually place it in and see if they can cut around that song, you know. So, at any rate, that would be long answer, shorter. You need to reach out to whoever you think might have any kind of a way in to a film project.
Sona, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Where could they find a list of music supervisors?
Well, there are no really full, complete official lists. There is a Guild of Music Supervisors
Guild of Music Supervisors, yeah. They have a website, right?
Yes, they do have a website. They have a list of their members. And I find that nowadays, because the branch has spread out so much, IMDb or places like that are actually really, really good resource. You just
IMDb
have to see.
IMDb is International Movie Database.
Yes, IMDb.com.
Right? IMDb.com.
And just look up what's current, what's playing in the theaters, what is that film that you just saw on TV or Netflix or somebody passed you along, and look at certain music supervisors' credits, and try to see if you can reach out to them. A lot of music supervisors are either associated with the production company that they work for or with, or a lot of them have their own shop or record label or something like that. So you have to be a little bit more resourceful than, let's say, just go out there. And that's another thing that we maybe did not or didn't mention, but kind of probably doesn't hurt to be repeated. If you decide to venture into this industry, the biggest virtue I think you can have is to be as resourceful as possible. There is no beaten path, and actually everybody mentioned pretty much that your way into the business is different. For each one of us, is different of how we ended up doing what we are doing. So,
you know, there's also film and music issues of Variety, which is a trade paper out of Los Angeles, and Hollywood Reporter also does a film and music TV issues. And usually somewhere in that issue is a list of the music executives at the major film companies.
Yeah, I think they have two or three times a year a music issue.
Right.
Right.
And so that sometimes can be a resource, just in terms of getting names of music executives and sometimes music supervisors and ways of contacting them.
Right on. Sure. We have a question from the audience. Hi, could you tell us your name?
Sure. My name is Taylor. And a question for all of you, but going off something that Jay said. I work with a musician who had a publishing deal with a good publisher, and he got songs into a lot of shows, Entourage, Gossip Girl, others. And he didn't have the paperwork as good as we would have liked it, and had a dispute with the band that he was performing with. Eventually prevailed, and he kept the songwriter credits, but the publisher, I would say, I guess went cold after that a little bit, maybe what you were saying, it was just too much trouble. So even though you said you can get blacklisted and then you're off the list, what would you say to someone who's had a problem? How do you get over that? Because he was very successful and wrote some really commercial music, but I think just the hassle of having to get a lawyer and all of that was just too much for the publisher. if that makes sense.
Well, in Hollywood, time heals all wounds, you know? And it's really true. I mean, let a period of time go by, and sometimes people will, if it's been successful, sometimes if you remind them of that success, it'll outweigh the memory of whatever problem that they had. Mm-hmm. And especially if you're real honest about the way you reapproach somebody and say, look, I'm really sorry that it worked out the way it did last time. If there was any other way, I would have, you know, had it go, I would have preferred for it to go another way. I just want you to know I'm still very interested in working with you. It doesn't hurt just to reach out and not be afraid to reach out. If you didn't light the bridge on fire, you know, the fact that the bridge burned doesn't mean that it's not going to be available to you again.
Okay, thank you.
That's a cool way to put it.
Yeah, that's really nice. We have another question from online. I guess this is for the whole panel. How has film scoring changed in the past 10 years?
The past how many years?
10.
Well,
as a young person, obviously.
As a young person. past 10 years, I can tell you how it's changed in the past 20 or 30 years.
Well, the obvious changes are the ones that you see in the technical aspects of it. You know, the thing I was saying about being able to make convincing sounding music in your bedroom. That's one of the obvious things that
that's
changed.
The single most important thing.
Another thing you mentioned, which is the advent of and the rise of an ambient sound effects almost type of score coming to the fro.
Right.
But as you said before, there's still melody involved. If you think about the one that won the Oscar this year, Trent Reznor and Atticus Ross's score to Social Network. You know, there is an ambient score, but it had that little piano motif in it.
Right.
So, I don't know, to me, the function of music in a film hasn't changed since the beginning.
And it will never change. It always, the technology and the language evolves. The language we're using today is certainly different than the language that Max Steiner used, but we're trying to accomplish the same thing, which is use the music to highlight drama in ways in which it doesn't interfere, but enhances. As the law is sort of, if it draws too much attention to itself, and it will take you out of the movie and has failed to do its job. It's not supposed to be invisible, but not blatantly visible. So I agree with George. I mean, when I moved out to LA in 1980 or thereabouts, I was the luckiest guy in the world. We were both very lucky in that we were, before the home studio thing became the way to accomplish a score, even if you're working on a student film, they had to come up with a little money to hire live musicians, i.e. students. And so, you know, it required that you knew how to write for instruments. Now, even if you're doing orchestra scores, technology is advanced enough so that, you know, if you know how to find the sample of the sound you're looking for, you can input that part into the computer and then turn that over to a team of people who will make it work as music. So the great news is if you are lacking, if let's say you're working in an orchestra environment for that movie you're working on, and you're lacking in with the technical proficiency in knowing how to write for an orchestra, just as long as you know how to input the correct sound and you surround yourself with the right support team, you can have a brilliant career as an orchestra writer. Again, right now, because pop music has so thoroughly taken over film music, you don't have to be exclusively schooled in the orchestra world as they used to have to be in the old days.
Yeah, I think that's a major difference. Yeah. I think the skill set has changed for composers. You know, it's as important, if not more important now, to know how to work a MIDI sequencer in a convincing way as it is to know how to transpose for a trumpet. You know, I mean, it just is. Mike Post is a friend of ours, and he has this thing that he says. He's a great composer. He did all the themes to Law and Order and Rockford Files, and I think they calculate that at any given moment, anywhere, somewhere on planet Earth, there's a piece of his music playing on television. That's how prolific this guy was. But he says he feels like, he says, seeing the technology change the way it has, he said this must have been what it was, what a blacksmith felt like at the end of the 19th century when he saw a Model T driving down the street. He has all these skill sets as he's honed over these years as a blacksmith, but a Model T is not going to need a horseshoe, you know? And so if you can adapt to those changes, then you can move ahead with the way things are being done. And composers coming up now, you know, that's part of the, what do they call it? You're a digital native. You're not a digital immigrant like we are. You know, we've had to immigrate to the digital world because we weren't born into it, so.
Right. But still, I think there is still an active search constantly on each and every project for that unique voice.
Yeah, right.
So in the basics of things, you still have to have that no matter what your tools are, no matter what Max Steiner, you know, in Gone with the Wind, 3 hours and 58 minutes of a movie that he scored in 2 weeks.
Right.
You know?
With some help.
With some help, but still, you know, even today, two weeks to actually score a film would be a very abbreviated amount of time.
Exactly.
It's getting closer to that, though.
Every day.
Brian asked, what are some of the do's and don'ts of, before I get to the question in email, if anyone has one, just come to the microphone. Brian asked, what are the do's and don'ts of working with, he uses the term prima donna directors.
Prima donna directors?
Yes.
Well, you know, I've worked with a lot of directors, and I don't know about you guys, but none of them have been that prima donna-like. I mean, they're all generally worried, is this film going to make it? You know, because directors, unlike composers, their careers can be broken overnight if their film, current film, doesn't do very well. Composers, however, are lucky. We can get attached to some turkeys, and it very rarely does anything long-lasting damage to our careers.
What I always remind myself of is that, you know, a director has probably lived with a film for 2-3 years,
right.
You know, from scripting it, working, rewriting it, begging to get the money put together, someone maybe to carry it, maybe your company to help put it out. And, you know, we come in with a month to go, 6 weeks to go, and it's a very different experience. And as I think you pointed out, Chris, or someone pointed out, very often the director has a very uncomfortable level and lack of vocabulary when it comes to music, so they feel uncomfortable about it to begin with. And they're sitting with someone they consider to be brilliant in that, so they're intimidated by what we do. So I think that whether they're a prima donna or whether they're first-time director or a 20th-time director, I just think as a composer, respecting the fact that you're dealing more with their child and you're going to put some clothes on the child or something. But to them, it's their child. And so it's a very sensitive issue, I find, with directors to be incredibly respectful, whether they're over the top demanding or not, but it's a very different relationship, and therefore, as you point out, Chris, a very different outcome should the film not work or work, you know.
Right.
So I made a good decision early on in my career not to punch this director. he had come by my studio and heard the stuff, it was a jazz type score, decided to come to the session at lunchtime to hear what we had recorded that morning. And while all the musicians were gathered around, we were in the control room, and I played him the opening cue, and he started shaking, and he turned red, and he said, "I can't believe you wrote that shit for my movie." And so everybody was just stunned to silence. And so this was early in my career. We had just had our daughter, but my neck was turning red. You know, I'm a Tennessee boy. I'm pretty big, and this guy was not, and he was being a real jerk. And so I was trying to figure out, I was standing there listening to him tell me how terrible it was and trying to figure out where I was going to hit him first. That was going to be my response. Then I remembered our daughter. Then I remembered how much I needed the gig. So I said, okay, tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to have the engineer play it again. When we get to the part you hate so bad that you want to puke, tell him to stop. So we played the cue, and he goes, oh, there it is, there it is. It was the B section of the song for him. So anyway, I said, okay, I'm going to have the engineer mute everything there, and I'm going to go out and play something on piano that I think you'll probably like better. And so I went out there and just jammed on some kind of a, you know, bullshit thing, and came back in, and he had tears in his eyes, and he goes, you're a genius. So be prepared for the roller coaster ride when you're working with a prima donna.
The answer to his question, I don't think working with a prima donna or a prima donna type should be any different than working with a director that's not that type, which is, again, you have to modify yourself as George did. And I was just about to tell an amazing experience I had, much the same, where I was working on a film called Rounders. Rounders. It was a gambling film with
Matt Damon
and somebody else. John Malkovich was in this movie. And this was a Miramax movie, my first Miramax movie. This is when Harvey Weinstein was running Miramax. We know Harvey, right? Big sort of big guy. And so they have the premiere of the film, and one of Harvey's guys comes up to me and says, Harvey wants to see you in your studio at 7 tomorrow morning. And the film's about
After the premiere.
And so, lo and behold, Harvey shows up right at 7 with his team of people, and he says, Chris, we have a problem with the score.
Wow.
I said, okay. Are you worried that the film is coming out in like 7 days? He goes, no, we're going to fix this. I want to tell you what this score should be.
Wow.
And so we sat down in my studio, and I had an upright piano, and the interesting thing was the piano was right here, Harvey was right here, and his assistant was over here. Harvey would turn to the assistant and say, Jim, could you tell Chris that what this film really needs
wow.
is a very emotional score? I don't like jazz, I've never liked jazz,
wow.
I never will like jazz. And Jim would say, Chris, what Harvey would like. And I finally said, Harvey, you can tell me directly. He goes, okay. Chris, pull up this, we pull up the scene. It's a romantic scene between Matt Damon and whatever the name of the actress was. It's like the first touchy-feely moment in the movie. And he goes, Chris, I need passion. What are you going to do? It's like just you. You have to think on your feet, friends. Think on your feet. That's what you have to do with someone who's got an intense attitude or belief. And so I said, let me see the scene again. So I saw the scene again. I go, how about this? And like you, I just bullshitted something.
Yeah.
He goes, That's my movie. And I said, you bet, of course it is. And I put on my cassette machine, recorded it, and that became the romantic theme for
that
movie. And he loved it so much, he hired me for like a 3-picture deal for Miramax. It was a great experience. I've had directors, or actually a lover of the director, who's the co-producer, music person. They were breaking up. This is a film called It had Michael Douglas in it. Wonder Boys with Michael Douglas. And she has appears to be doing some source music. And actually, an assistant of mine calls the source music Muzak by mistake. Oh God! She had a complete meltdown and she ran into the bathroom and she goes, Curtis, what Muzak? She goes and runs into my bathroom and locks herself in, and she won't come out. It was one of the most bizarre moments ever.
Wow.
She finally came out and said, okay, I'm so sorry. Let's get this right. And so you fix things. There you go.
Could you please tell us your name and your question?
Yes, my name is Ken Knight. I had two questions, please. First of all, what instruments do you use when you're composing, when you're actually doing the composing? What instruments? And also, as far as the arrangement that goes into the scoring studio, how much do you try to do the arrangement yourself? Who fleshes out the arrangement and makes it a complete scoring arrangement?
Okay, I'm primarily a keyboard player, but I do play guitar and mandolin and string instruments like that. And so sometimes I play those instruments on my score, but usually if I'm composing, it's at the piano, primarily a keyboard player. And I send over very specific MIDI files in terms of how I want things to be broken down instrument-wise to my orchestrators, and they're the ones that use Finale or Sibelius to make it into the paper score.
Thank you.
Do you have assistants who will come in and refine your samples?
So no, I don't.
More polished.
No.
For the show and tells?
No, I just do it all myself.
Okay. You know, it's interesting because once upon a time, going back to the old days, because we've kind of been around for a while, what they used to do in show and tells was you'd sit at the piano mm-hmm. and the picture would roll and you'd play that theme against the picture wild at the piano. The directors would never hear what it was really going to sound like until they walked on the scoring stage. And your job was to try to express to them as concretely as possible exactly what it was going to sound like. And if you did a pretty good job when they walk in the scoring stage, they go, wow, this sounds exactly what you made me believe it was going to sound like. Now it's entirely different. As you know, it's all about offering a mocked-up version of that cue to sound as precisely as humanly possible or mechanically possible to what the final product's going to be. In my case, I will bring live instruments in to enhance things. What you heard here, this cue right here, the mocked-up version, I actually bought a live violin in since it was the principal instrument. Everything else was fake. Some percussion, I think I used live percussion as well. But most everybody writes at the synthesizer now, you know. My system is very weird because I was brought up thinking that in order for a composer to be credible, you know, I had this Herman issue, and Bernard Herman believed that if you turn a sketch over to an orchestrator, you are a hack. And so, remember that? Yeah. So, indeed, I think it's a good lesson to even young composers who ultimately are going to be writing at a synth, you know, that's just the way it is now. Do spend some time trying to write it at a piano. Don't let your fingers do the talking, but use it as a facility and do the pencil to paper thing, because it forces you to think about the music in a way that you don't think about when you're sitting at the keyboard. To go back to that earlier question, of course, when you're writing at a synth, you ultimately, whether you do it consciously or not, you will start to write around what the samples do best. And that's why, as you know, one of the biggest changes that has happened to scoring movies these days is the ever-presence of drones and how it's neutralized castrated harmony, you know. Harmony's become a lot simpler because of the fact that synths love drones, you know. Does that kind of answer your question?
Well, let me add to that, because I think probably what we all share is I love the writing part, I love the orchestrating part, I even love the mocking up part. You know, I really enjoy the technology. So I tend, like probably these guys, to do their own orchestrating and whatnot. But, you know, there's a really cool, one of the libraries a lot of us use is the Vienna Symphony Library. And if you go to their website, there's a really cool link to Wall Street Journal story of Alan Menken's score to Tangled with the guy who's pretty much a composer, but he, part of what he does is make his living mocking up things for people and orchestrating, and they show you, he plays for you Alan Menken's what he was synth, and then he plays for you the Vienna Library version, then you hear the score version mm-hmm. of it, and you can really see the progression. Just on a little web link, and I would suggest you go. It's the Vienna Symphony Library.
Are some films being finished using actually just a synthesized music?
Are there films being finished that way?
Are many done like that, just synthesized?
Yeah, tons of,
What did you just say?
Are films, final versions of film scores often synthesized
yes,
versions?
Yes,
oh yeah, gosh, yeah.
They are.
Especially independent films, just the budget, what it allows or doesn't allow, is a lot of what I do, just again, because of budgets, is you might have something that sounds like a full orchestra, but there might be 30 real players and the rest is all sample. There might be 10. There are scores I've done where it sounds all real, but really it's only the saxophone because a sampled sax might not have worked for what I wanted to write.
I think most scores you hear today are hybrids.
Yeah.
You know, there are going to be somewhere samples playing along with the real instruments.
And the smart thing to do is, in order to make your synth score stand out from the rest, I always suggest you would include at least one live instrument.
Yeah.
Because I get demo tapes all the time, incredibly gifted writers, but often the sonorities become been there, done that. And the ones that generally stand out, that sparkle a little bit above and beyond the others, are the ones that that have a solo instrument or some color. You were talking about bringing something specific to the table. That's one of the lessons that most agents will tell you. What you need to do as a film composer, back when we started, was gut. You aspire to write in as many different styles as possible. But at the end of the day, most film composers are known for one or two things that they do repeatedly really well. You know, they bring something unique to the table. So as a composer, you have to discover what that voice is, you know. Now, I will finish up by saying, how do you write? What's the method that you write? If you're uncomfortable with synths and you know ultimately that you've got to present your cues, even if it's being done with a live group to the director as a mock-up, if you can afford it, get someone to help you. You know, write it however you need to write it and just get it mocked up somehow. That's my system. My system is very strange. It's the weirdest one in LA, I think. John Williams? No, John Williams is totally old school. He still sits at the piano, the grand piano, and does sketches by hand. He refuses to do mock-ups. He will play the themes on the piano for the director. That's it. That's what you get. Jerry Goldsmith, modified. He still wrote at the piano, did sketches, but then followed them up with a mock-up. That's kind of what I do. I sit at the piano, I do sketches, and then follow those sketches up with a mock-up. So the mock-ups go out to my orchestrators just as an oral representation of what they're already seeing in the sketch. But the sketch is the law.
Thank you so much. Okay.
Before we move on, could we get the mics a little bit closer? Just got a text from our sound man. Jace, you're fine. You're loud and clear. That's great. Thank you. Question over here. Please tell us your name and your question.
Hi, I'm Jack. My question is, have you ever had to compose music for a film that you just absolutely did not like? Maybe you despised it. Maybe you didn't like.
Absolutely. Yeah. Have we ever composed music for a film that we despised or hated?
Despised.
Yeah, I've composed music for films that I thought were really pieces of shit. The trick is not to condescend in your writing, you know?
Right.
I make myself believe that this director is going to win the Oscar. I make myself believe that these performances that these actors are giving are brilliant performances. And I try to make my writing on a level as if all the things that I hate about the film were actually, you know, great. And because if I condescend in my writing, I hate my music. I learned that the first time I did a film that I didn't like very much, and I didn't pay attention to the writing, and I wrote really terrible music, and I hated the way that felt. So I found a way to make myself find something about the film I like, even if it's just an exercise that I create for myself, to do something different with it. I try to find something that inspires me.
That's a perfect answer. When I was studying with David Raxon at UCLA, the guy who wrote the scores to Laura and the Bad and the Beautiful, one of the most significant things he said to me that I remember was, remember, each film, no matter how bad it might be, you have to treat it like it was Gone with the Wind. So indeed, don't make the mistake of writing down. What you ultimately have to do is find a way to align yourself with a movie, even if you have to force it. Because remember, you don't want the director to think that you're not in love with his movie, because you are his best friend. And as a matter of fact, you know, probability is that you're one of the first people to actually see the film that didn't work on it. You're the first outsider. So when you come to see the film, even if you think the film's a disaster, you have to put on like, this is a great movie. I can't thank you enough. I'm so looking forward to doing this. The ideas are already coming to me. I'm so excited. You know,
wasn't it Raxson who said that being a film scorer is a lot like being an undertaker sometimes?
Oh yeah, that's right. That was his thing.
You
can dress up.
You can dress up. I can dress up the corpse, but I can't bring. I can't
bring
life into
life.
It.
Yeah. Can't bring it back to life.
Can't bring life into it.
Right. So do you understand this? And I agree with George wholeheartedly. Look for something about the film that can challenge you musically. If that's what you need to put in your head and go, man, I get a chance to write in this style, which I've never done before. Or this is an action scene, which is going to be pretty challenging, and I'm looking forward to doing that. And there's always something that can be found beneficial in even the worst of movies. And if you can't find it, then you better work hard on figuring out how to find it and making sure that you deliver the stuff with a smile and you're the team player. I'm always with the director. They're very, oh, Chris, I'm so worried about this. You know, what do you think? What do you think? Is it too long, too short? No, this is the perfect length. I wouldn't touch a frame of it.
Please don't touch a frame of it.
Yeah, that kind of thing. So you have to do a lot of bullshitting. You know what I'm saying? Yes, you do.
Question over here? Name and question, please.
My name's John, and I was wondering what your home studios look like, because you've mentioned them before, and that is very important to build a good one. So I guess, like, how would you build a home studio, or what do your home studios look like?
Good question.
Jay, you want to start? He wants to know what our home studios look like.
Okay, mine, I guess one of the things I could have said in the 10-year, what's changed, one of the things that's changed with my home studio is the success now of 64-bit computers as opposed to the 32-bit. And the reason that's important is these libraries that we mock up with require just so much memory. So that, the newer computers, the 64-bit computers, have essentially access to, they say infinite memory, but never believed that, but to tons more. So that a year and a half ago, it required 5 different Macs and PCs all locked together with each one having bits of the library on it. Now it's one computer that can have all of it on it. So I have one main DAW, you know, we call it the digital audio workstation computer. I happen to use Cubase as the program I like. And then I have probably 500 gigabyte hard drives in that computer with different libraries on them. And really beyond that, double monitors and then the keyboard I'm going to use to input into. Downstairs I have my piano because I still do like to go to the piano and compose there as well, as opposed to a digital, you know, a fake piano. And then there's, you know, spaces that I can record in. So I have, you know, one or two really great microphones that I can pull out if I need to bring in that one live player like Chris talked about for mock-ups. And then, of course, places for people to sit and tons of scores, classical scores and CDs and just the usual kind of thing. But it's become a very compressed situation and than it was just a few years ago, where it took a lot more space. Mixing boards now can all be done internally to the computer, and it's really made a much cleaner environment for me. So I don't know if that helps you, but that's how mine looks.
We can we have time for about one more question. Do we have one? Please tell us your name and question, please.
Yeah, my name's Joe. As far as like finding work for a young film composer, and you've already touched on this very much, but I've started with another composer buddy, a film scoring company, and we're trying to kind of expand our clientele and, you know, pick up work here and there. We've done some independent films and some student films, but really, I feel like going out and hitting up people and reaching out and making calls and making emails hasn't gotten us the amount of work that we were hoping for. And it's almost like taking longer, you know, it's taken a while to find the films that we have done. So what is the best way to, I guess, reach out to people and, you know, sell yourself, let them know that you are good at what you're doing, but also you don't want to be too like, oh, please let me score your film, please let me score your film. But you also want to come from a place, an honest place, and just tell them that you know you're experienced and you want to do professional work for them. And as far as like getting away from the student films, you know, we're looking for independent films. What's a good way to kind of go about doing something like that?
You know, years ago, I was in the audience, and Alan Silvestri was sitting up on a panel with some other heavy hitters at that time, and I asked him the same question. And he said, well, just keep at it and hope that you get lucky. That's all the advice he could give. I almost asked for my money back. You know?
There's the nugget right there.
I had to pay money to hear that. But keeping at it is the main thing. It brings up another point, too. More and more there are being organized music libraries. And Selena, you may know something about the use of them and companies that composers are writing for and actually having their works being represented by music libraries and then licensed to be used in films. So that they're, you know, that's another revenue stream for some composers, is to have your work represented by a music library and then have that library license the work to movies and television shows. And unfortunately for scores that are created by one composer throughout, more and more because of budget constraints, films, particularly television, is depending on music libraries to provide the music for their shows.
Yeah, because it's just the timing is everything in film music in general, no?
Yeah, it's true. Everything.
So when you're working on a TV show, you have to turn around incredible amount of creative decisions, period, in a very short period of time. So it helps to actually go to one place, one resource. And I mean, it's going to sound awful, you know, give me five oranges, two bananas, you know what I mean, this and that.
Yeah.
But if your one episode or one little film with a very limited budget that you have to satisfy many, many music users with relies on the music heavily, you might just as well go to a music library and ask them, okay, give me the best of your jazz, the best of your alt rock sounding like I don't know which band, the best of, you know, anything you have sounding like Beyonce or something like that, and select for your show.
Well, this may even be just really quick. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to add to you, this is the toughest question to answer. It truly is. And I know exactly what's going through your head right now. And like George, when I was starting off, we were in the audience, and that was the question that was screaming in our brains. How is this going to happen? How can I make a career? There is no answer, no quick answer. It sounds to me like you're a hustler, like you're out there and you're trying your best to put your name out there. So you're doing the right thing. You're definitely not an introvert. I get the feeling, Amelia, you're not this quiet introvert type person. If that was the case, you'd be in desperate trouble. You're putting yourself out there. As long as you continue to try to use your imagination to drum up concepts of how you can continue to promote yourself, even if it requires doing something that's offbeat, if you've got the guts to do it, great. And even if you don't have the guts to do it, try to work on that as well. Because I, you know, we all went through this thing of picking up the phone and trying to get our names out or making a connection with a director on a movie that we were, certainly our credits weren't as noticeable as the kind of composer they were probably looking for. And it's that fear of picking up the phone and making the call, and how do you get over that fear so that you're confident enough to get through that phone call. My thing, it finally, for me, was for that sort of 5 minutes I'm going to be on the phone with these people, or I'm going to be in the office delivering a demo, I have to think I'm John Williams. You know, the minute the meeting or the phone call is over with, I can go, phew, me, John Williams, what a joke. You know, but you have to act the part, you see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So it sounds to me like you're doing the right thing. You just continue putting your name out there. Again, I don't know what it's like here. I can't say specifically what you need to do locally to make a career happen. Jay touched upon that. But certainly if you were to move to LA, I could help in a more tangible way. But the concepts still remain the same.
Right.
You know? Does that make sense? Sort
yeah,
of?
Yeah.
Keep doing. Sorry, I don't have the answer. but keep doing what you're doing. I have a really good feeling it's going to work out for you.
Thank you. All right, well, these guys are going to hang out for a couple minutes, so if you weren't able to ask your question, feel free to come on up. We're going to take a short 10-minute or so break for intermission before we kick up the songwriting portion. I believe we have some refreshments upstairs on the third floor. Can we get a round of applause for our panelists? Jay Weigel, Donna, Chris, George. Thank you very much, and we'll be back in 10 with the song portion.